Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning. Good morning. My name is Keith Burdett. I'm Secretary of Commerce. We want to thank all of you, almost 200 people registered, pre-registered for this event. I want to thank all of you for being here this morning. I get to do some introductions this morning. I also want to give you some logistical information. First of all, today's conference is being live streamed. That's why I'll pay attention to this guy over in the corner who will point to me every once in a while and tell me when to start, when to stop. Secondly, the restroom facilities, you have to use these two front side doors so that we all can watch you come and go as you leave and come in and come out of the conference. But those these two front doors are the only way out. So if you need to leave to make a call or anything else, please use these two front doors. Today's event is actually the beginning of a very exciting process. There's a reason why I think all of you are here. It is exciting. The opportunity associated with this grant process, the Power Initiative, is exciting for all of us and certainly exciting for the state. I want to start by extending the very, very, very sincere apologies of the governor, who planned to be here as late as yesterday. And as you know, there's this little event going on in Charleston that is attracting a little attention. And he was required to be in Charleston this morning. In fact, I want to extend my apologies early. About 15 minutes before 9, I received a call to say that I am being summoned back to Charleston to the House Finance Committee. I would rather stay with you. But, so I will have to leave a little early, but nonetheless, we're gonna start off big and start off strong. I can tell you what we really hope to accomplish here today and in the next few months could have a huge impact on, I know, the organizations you represent, but more significantly to the state and the state's economy. The significance of today's workshop is vested not just in the huge attendance today, but the folks who are helping us participate and helping educate you about this process and what we think we can accomplish. I need to thank a few people, and I will not nearly thank enough because there are so many people that have worked on this process, but I need to thank a few people. First of all, I need to thank the ARC team itself. Earl Gould, Guy Land, his entire group of people have been working with us constantly over the last several months to actually work up to this event, to make sure that we were able to engage in the process effectively, that we had knowledge and resources that we needed to be, that they would understand more personally the opportunities and the challenges that we're all facing. And they have been outstanding partners. I cannot thank them enough. I also need to thank the U.S. Economic Development Administration, representatives here from there, from the U.S. Department of Agriculture, from the U.S. Export Assistance Center, from the AML funds. So many federal and state organizations are represented here today, not only to learn for themselves, but also to help you do the best job you can in competing for the resources that are available. It is truly, truly a joint effort. I also need to thank a couple people in my own organization, Mary Jo Thompson, who is the ARC alternate, James Bush, who is our kind of director of ARC activities in the Western Indiana Department of Commerce, have been outstanding to get this, to help get it organized and in place. Today's workshop is really designed to walk you through the big picture goals of what this Power Initiative is, but it also is designed to help you navigate the fine print. This is a rare opportunity, and we know it. And I am an incredibly selfish person. There's $50 million that will be spread across the Appalachian region, and I want it all. And I want to make sure that you all are equipped with the resources to get as much of it as we possibly can. We're the only state that is fully within, the entire state is part of the ARC region. I remind that to Earl often. So today we're going to go over funding priorities, what the funders are looking for in applications, what the match requirements look like, what other resources you might want to include in your applications, what some of the best practices are to help sharpen your thinking, and the technical assistance opportunities to help strengthen your applications. And I will remind you that while we talk about $50 million, the truth is the PIER dollars are offered jointly by the Appalachian Regional Commission and the Economic Development Administration, which together is making available $68.5 million for these implementation grants. So we all talk about 50, but if you take into consideration the EDA, the federal EDA's participation in this process, the true scope of this opportunity is closer to $68.5 million. It's an incredible, incredible opportunity. And looking around the room at many of the organizations that are here, those of you who write to me constantly looking for money, this is your day, because these folks actually have some, and I never do. So I can't emphasize enough how important this work is. This workshop is about accessing additional resources that will help transform our economy. As important as your individual goals are, and they are important and respected, the mission is to strengthen the economy and the quality of life in the state of West Virginia. It is to lift us all up. And if we do it in parts and pieces that make a cohesive plan to reinvigorate our economy and expand the opportunities in our state, then we will have accomplished our job. So I say again, I thank you very much. One, for what you do in your own communities, in your own cities and towns, and across the state of West Virginia. And thank you for taking your time, which I know is incredibly busy. The truth of it is, the smaller the organization, the more time conflicted you are, because you're doing so many different things to accomplish so many different goals. And you're going to take a day to come here so that you can be better at what you're doing at home. And I truly, truly appreciate that, and I hope that it works incredibly well for you in the course of this process. So my role this morning is to say thank you, to welcome you, to give you some instructions about the process, and also I get the opportunity to introduce some partners that are that have been instrumental in our operations. And there has been no stronger partner than our congressional delegation. You know, in this day of divided government and all of the conflict, I did mention I was going back to Charleston, didn't I? It is a truly nonpartisan, non-political process that we are undertaking today. It is represented in the attention that is being given to it by the congressional delegation, which we are honored to have several representatives here today. And we want to give each of them an opportunity to say a few words before the panel start. So this morning, my first introduction is Keith McIntosh. He is the projects coordinator for the office of Senator Joe Manchin. Keith.
Good morning. Thank you, Mr. Secretary. I bring greetings from Senator Manchin. He apologizes that he could not join us today, but he certainly wants to know what we are doing. And I will be certain to relay this to him. On behalf of the citizens of the Mountain State, and as your United States Senator, it is my privilege to welcome those attending the ARC Partnerships for Opportunity and Workforce and Economic Revitalization Workshop. We know in the Mountain State that by working together, we can overcome any obstacle to move our state and nation forward. One of the key ways that we meet challenges in West Virginia is by setting our priorities based on our values and knowing how much we love our great state and the small towns and communities that made us who we are. That is why I sincerely appreciate the Appalachian Regional Commission, the Economic Development Administration, and the many speakers and organizations involved in this important workshop today. In March 2016, ARC and EDA announced a new $68.5 million federal funding opportunity entitled Power 2016. The primary objective of the Power grants are to invest in economic and workforce development projects and activities in Appalachian communities that have been adversely impacted by the recent changes in the coal industry. I applaud everyone in attendance today for the important work that you're doing on the ground every day to grow our economy and attract jobs to the Mountain State. And I encourage you to contact my office if I can help you navigate the federal grant process for Power 2016 or any other federal funding opportunities. Again, I appreciate the efforts of all who made this initiative possible. Your work provides an empowering opportunity to countless West Virginians, and it is a tremendous benefit to our entire state. Please accept my best wishes. With warm regards, Joe Manchin III, United States Senator. Thank you.
Thank you, Keith. Our next speaker is Aaron Spork, who is the Economic Development Officer for the Office of Senator Shelley Moore Capito. Aaron?
Thank you, Secretary. The Senator is sorry that she cannot be with you today. She has to be in D.C. to take care of her duties there. On behalf of her, I would like to welcome Earl Gould, the Federal Co-Chair for the Appalachian Regional Commission, to West Virginia and thank him for hosting today's important discussion. The ARC provides critical resources to improve our state's infrastructure, strengthen our economy, expand access to broadband, and promote entrepreneurship. The $50 million that ARC has available, as well as the $18.5 million that EDA has available from this year, has the potential to boost our state's struggling economy. As a member of the Senate Appropriations Committee, I am committed to being an advocate for the ARC. I am pleased that the current FY 2017 appropriations includes an increase in funding for ARC. These historic increases in funding will allow West Virginia communities to access much needed funding to spur economic revitalization. I'm especially pleased that ARC will be focusing their efforts on broadband deployment thanks to my efforts during last year's ARC reauthorization. In order for our state's economy to truly rebound, we must make investments to improve our infrastructure. Whether it's broadband infrastructure, water and sewer extensions, workforce development, or infrastructure to foster entrepreneurship, we must focus federal resources to projects that will make these critical infrastructure improvements. I know that many of these entities that are here today are focusing on strategic infrastructure investments and improvements, and I encourage ARC to fund them. Again, I'm sorry that I cannot be with you today. It is an honor to serve you in the United States Senate. Sincerely, Shelley Moore Capito, United States Senator.
Thanks, Aaron. And both the senator's offices have been very, very engaged in this process, and we're very appreciative of that. Rod Rogers is the district director for the office of David McKinley. Is he here this morning? I didn't see him come in. He may be a little late, so we'll look for him later. Fred Joseph is here. I knew he was here someplace. Fred Joseph is the district director for the office of Alex Mooney, Congressman Alex Mooney. Fred?
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Just a word for myself personally, on such a beautiful day outside, it's encouraging to see the brightest people in West Virginia here today to move us forward. And you're to be commended, and thank you for being here. As the secretary said, I am the district director in the 2nd Congressional District, and I represent Congressman Alex Mooney. And he sends his message. Members of the Appalachian Regional Commission and West Virginia Development Office and all attendees, I'm sorry that I'm unable to be here in person. I would like to thank the Appalachian Regional Commission and the West Virginia Development Office for hosting this event, and I hope that I will be able to attend in the future. A special welcome to those here to seek the help made available through the Partnership for Opportunity and Workforce and Economic Revitalization, the POWER Act. Initiative in a multi-agency effort to assist communities negatively impacted by the changes in the coal industry and the power industry. The Appalachian Regional Commission is an important component of our West Virginia economy, promoting economic development and improving people's lives throughout the state. As an organization of elected officials, business people, and community leaders, the ARC is truly a grassroots organization. It works to better the livelihood of our citizens, is something that regarded highly, and will help the ARC move our state looking forward to a brighter future. I want you to know that as your United States representative, I am here to help with any grant funding opportunities, requests you may have, and if you ever need assistance, don't hesitate to call our office, whether it be Charleston, Martinsburg, or in D.C. Thank you all again for all you do for the 2nd Congressional District in West Virginia, and God bless.
And last but certainly not least is Michael Chirico, who is the District Director for the Office of Evan Jenkins.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary, for getting my last name right. good morning. My name is Michael Chirico. I'm the District Director for Congressman Jenkins. It is an honor to be here on behalf of the Congressman, and I wanted to share a brief greeting with you from him in D.C. Dear friends, I was honored to receive your invitation to participate in today's workshop, and I regret that I am unable to join you, but I would like to offer my sincere thanks for the work you do every day to enhance the quality of life in West Virginia and Appalachia. I would also like to thank the regional councils that are uniquely structured and supported by the Appalachian Regional Commission. My office works hand in hand with these regional councils to host economic development roundtables, to solicit input from local stakeholders, coordinate on possible funding sources for grants, and provide letters of support to secure funds that will invest in water, sewer, and highway and other infrastructure projects. As a member of the House Appropriations Committee, I will continue to ensure that West Virginia gets the federal resources we need to maintain our water and highway infrastructure and invest in our communities. Our state is the only state that is fully encompassed within Appalachia, and the ARC is the only federal agency focused exclusively on helping and investing in our region. I hope collaborative efforts, like today's workshop, will promote solutions and create plans to usher in a new Appalachia where our children will thrive. Thank you, as always. I'm honored to serve as your voice in Congress and stand ready to help West Virginia in any way possible. Evan H. Jenkins, Member of Congress. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Okay, so we've now heard from those folks who've helped make the money possible. It's time to start talking to those folks who are going to help us get hold of it. Now, I was sitting here talking to Earl, and I said, so Earl, are you actually on the committee that will review these applications? And he said, no. And I said, well, then I don't need to suck up to you. Let's move on to somebody else. He then went back and said, no, you still need to suck up to me. So listen, there's been no better partner for the state of West Virginia than our next speaker. Earl has been a constant a friend to the state. He has been an advocate for those things that are so important to our future. He has taken a very hands-on approach to much of our work. He is a guy that wants to see it and touch it and feel it, and has engaged us on all of the great opportunities I don't use the word challenges, all the great opportunities that the state has. And we're honored and so very, very pleased to have with us today the co-chairman of the Appalachian Regional Commission, Earl Gould.
Man, it is so great to see all of you this morning. This is, when you walk out of here, our hope is you're going to be exhausted and you're going to have a lot of new ideas and you've met a lot of new people. You know, before I start, I want to thank Keith, Secretary Burdett, for his leadership, his work, and the support that he's given ARC over the last several years. Also, I need to recognize Mary Jo Thompson and James Bush. Mary Jo, of course, represents the governor at ARC, and we all know what James does, because he, how many folks in here have received an ARC grant at some point in the last couple years? So yeah, everybody knows James Bush. I also want to thank the congressional folks for coming, Keith, Aaron, Fred, and Michael. We had set up, we had organized when we were going to do the different workshops around the region, probably early April. And we had a schedule and everything was like focused on how we're going to do it and how we're going to do it, who's going to be there and what the deal was. And then I was invited to meet with the West Virginia delegation in Washington on this day about right now. And so we were very appreciative of the fact that they were very gracious and said, you know, you should probably go to West Virginia and do the work, and then you can come and talk to us later on. But thank you for you guys for coming today, and we really appreciate your support and the work that you do. You know, 6 years ago when I started this job, the power, 51% of the power generated in this country came from coal. And over the last 6 years, efficiencies, natural gas from Ohio, Pennsylvania, West Virginia, have really taken over the market. The United States is now one of the largest producers of oil and gas in the world. And all these things, you know, coal is going to continue to be an important part of the West Virginia economy. But in 2015, it made up about 30% of the electricity generated in the country. And as we go forward, that number is probably going to fluctuate and go down a little bit more. And the changes in this energy market, in cities, there's some really good things that happen in terms of the air, in terms of prices. In Appalachia, not so much. In Appalachian communities, a whole lot, not so much. And we've got really serious challenges, economic challenges, for families and communities and folks who've worked very hard over the last several hundred years in making this country a great place. Our response and the President's response to these challenges has really been fourfold within the Power Initiative. There's first of all, he proposed in 2016 tax credits for clean coal technology when they're implemented in power plants. The second point was of the Power Initiative was to support the UMW Health and Welfare Fund benefits for retired miners and also for health facilities in West Virginia. Those pieces of legislation are critical. They were introduced by Senator Capito and Congressman McKinley of West Virginia. We've also encouraged and recommended and asked for the release of funds that are in the Abandoned Mineland Fund to the tune of about $200 million a year for each year for 5 years. And that legislation has been introduced by Congressman Rogers of Kentucky and has been joined by co-sponsors by Congressman Jenkins and Mooney, as well as a whole list of other bipartisan members of the United States Congress. And the fourth piece is really what we're here to talk about, and it's really what we're here to work on. And that is a series of target investments by several agencies. In fiscal year 16, Congress appropriated, and the President signed into law, a budget that provided EDA with $15 million to invest in the Power Initiative, and provide ARC with $50 million to invest in diversifying the economies of coal-impacted communities. And then, for 2017, the President requested a second $50 million. And the House Appropriations Committee has already acted, and they've recommended that same number. And the Senate last week adopted the Energy Appropriations Bill for 2017, and lo and behold, that bill also included $50 million for power. So in plain English, or simple English, the ARC is on the path forward to have available $100 million to invest in coal-impacted communities for economic diversification over the next 21 months. This is in addition to the ARC's regular program of $70 million a year that goes to do critical work throughout the region, and hopefully will also be used to help support these investments as well. When we say coal-impacted communities, we mean communities that are affected by mine closures, communities that have been part of the supply chain of the mining industry, and communities who have experienced coal-fired power plants being shuttered. It's important from our point of view to remember why ARC and EDA have these funds. And it's really pretty simple. It's because the Congress of the United States, the President of the United States, have entrusted us to partner with folks like you to make a series of strategic investments that support the economic diversification of Appalachian's coal-impacted communities. And the purpose of today's conversation is really to continue a series of conversations that we've been having throughout the region, particularly here in West Virginia, with leaders of Appalachian coal communities who are interested and very dedicated to being our partners to take on these economic challenges. And today we hope to help lay out that roadmap for securing the federal funds to make these strategic investments that support the diversification of coal-impacted communities that benefit Appalachians working families and provide a return to U.S. taxpayers. As we go through the day, there's going to be a lot of information, a lot of information. There are going to be a lot of conversations. And I know that you're going to remember every bit of information that you need to have. There is going to be no piece of paper that you're going to lose. You will have everything you need when you walk out here. And so it's important to remember these words. ARC.gov/power, because it is the website that where you'll be able to find that piece of paper that the dog ate, or the piece of paper they got left behind someplace. That idea, it's where you can find the webinars that you missed. It's where you can go back and actually you'll be able to upload this session and see what people said and how people talked about different issues. It is where you can find the FFO, it is where you can find the FAQs, it is where you can find the web portals where you can submit applications to ARC for both implementation and TA funds. It is the place to go. Remember, ARC.gov/power. Tattoo it on your arm until you complete at least one application. Now, everyone in this room is interested in seeing how they can use the power program to help their community. We all have that in common. Everybody is here for that reason. To be successful, you're going to need partners. And so it's really important today that you not just sit next to your buds, the folks you came with, the folks you see every day, but it's important that you reach out and you find other folks in this room, other folks who have that, share that same commitment, that same drive, that same vision. And the reason we suggest that is because we know that's how it works. This is our fourth session. This is our fourth session, and we know that in every one of these sessions, when we get people in room together who don't know each other but who have a common vision, a common energy, that bringing them together gives them the ability to have applications and proposals that are stronger than they were before. The power grant process is different than the regular ARC process. We're using a pre-application, and the pre-application is submitted directly to ARC by way of a web portal. While the application is not being submitted to the state, it does not mean that the state is not an active partner and very involved in helping us solicit, develop, run these sessions, and also in the review and the analysis of the applications. It's also always important to remember that with ARC, that in order for us, for the commission, to issue a grant, there are two things that are really important. The one is the agreement of the state's alternate, And the second is the agreement of the federal co-chair, that all grants, regardless of what purpose or what they're for or where they're to, always require those two things. There are no pre-approved lists of eligible communities. Applicants need to explain why they believe they fall within the eligibility of coal-impacted communities. We decided early on that we could certainly do a list, and we would know that that list was going to be wrong, that there was going to be something off of it, something we didn't include, something we left out. And we thought it was better for folks to self-identify, to explain to us why they fit in this category. We also don't have a deadline. So you're not under any pressure to complete this by next week or the week after that. But we will run out of money. We will exhaust our resources at some point. And that's when the deadline closes. There is no state allocation, as Keith mentioned, which means there's no minimum and there's no maximum. While ARC has received funds for power, the ARC authorization law has not changed. The eligibility for grants are the same folks, and the same people who can apply. We don't give grants to businesses, but we do give grants to organizations that help and support businesses. We do give grants to organizations like CDFIs who help provide capital to businesses. We do provide support to organizations that help businesses be engaged in exports and other technical assistance activity. So while we do not put, so our law has not changed in terms of who is eligible. Matching share requirements are the same as the regular program. And while we understand that that provides some challenges, it's also one of the reasons why the ARC and EDA FFOs were released together. It was to provide the opportunity for the two agencies to work together, to consult with each other, and help manage and minimize some of the matching share requirements. We will also have a webinar on the issue of match. We'll talk about it today as well. But we would also say that we have learned over the years that it's always important to have a little bit of local skin in the game. It kind of just makes it a little more real and a little bit more ownership of what the activity and what the project is. On March 17th, ARC and EDA did publish its FFO advertising the availability of power implementation grants, ARC at $45 million and EDA at $18 million. A few weeks later, ARC published a second FFO providing $1.2 million allocation for technical assistance grants to help pay for grant writers, development of local economic development plans. Our goal with the TA grants is to fund efforts to develop more thoughtful, competitive, sustainable applications. TA can pay for the grant writing, it can pay for the feasibility, it can finance the planning activity. We really are encouraging folks to take those few minutes. It doesn't eliminate you from the implementation grants, but it does help make your implementation grant a lot stronger, a lot more thought out. Now, in terms of what types and what are the grants that we're looking for, well, we expect that the average size of grants will be between $500 and $1.5 million, a little bit different than what the normal area development grants often look like. And since there are no state applications, we are really encouraging the projects reach across county lines, they reach across state lines. Our economies don't recognize borders that were drawn in 1863. They don't recognize borders that were drawn in after the Revolutionary War. And it's important that as we plan for the economy of the next generation, of the next century, that we also take into account and we understand how the economy works. So collaboration is so critical. This is not your typical Friday night high school football game rivalry. It's not. This is more like West Virginia University going to the national championships. And if you recall, some of those great teams that went really far, it wasn't just folks from West Virginia on the team. That it was a collaboration of talent, of coaches and fans and supporters and players who were in support and loved West Virginia and wanted to see it move forward, but it was a lot of folks. And to be successful in this effort, it's going to take a lot of folks. And we're going to need to reach out to have a collaboration, have a team that really reaches beyond those boundaries, whether they're county or their state, to make sure that everyone benefits and everyone grows. Leverage is important. The more you're able to leverage this grant and leverage this activity, the stronger it is. It's also important that there have been some assessment and some planning, some thought to this. While we're very appreciative of ideas that are written on paper napkins, great place to start, but it's only a great place to start. And it's important that as we go forward, if you have if you're going to have a competitive application, it's going to be well thought out. But remember that at the end of the day, when ARC and EDA have these funds available, it's to make strategic investments that support the economic diversification of coal communities. In the FFOs that was published, ARC did list four priorities. And it's not to say that those are the only things we're going to do, because we're going to do other things. There's no question about that. We're going to support other big ideas and other priorities of folks who've given a lot of thought and dedication to work. But the four priorities that we've talked about are really important, I think, for this discussion today. They include workforce development, to make sure that the West Virginia workforce is more competitive and is able to move forward with the next generation of jobs, that we are interested and we're very happy to support broadband development, particularly the last miles. We understand that can be an important game changer in many small communities throughout Appalachia. Entrepreneurship and entrepreneurial education is a piece that ARC has been talking about for a number of years. Small business development is such a critical part of our economy. While it's only onesies and Tuesdays, it's often also about instilling an entrepreneurial environment, an entrepreneurial ecosystem, so that communities can sustain themselves, can build, can take advantage of opportunities. And the fourth priority is about developing and supporting business clusters. There are a lot of opportunities throughout Appalachia and in West Virginia. A couple of years ago, during the Rural Accelerator Jobs program, we funded, there were 13 awards nationally by EDA and a variety of other federal agencies. Five of those went to Appalachia, and two of those came to West Virginia. And the work in that area was really critical because it helped lay the foundation for a whole variety of activities moving forward. Now, the other place to look and for guidance and directions is also to look at the ARC strategic plan that we adopted in October of last year, where we talk about not only our priorities, but also our principles, about how important it is to look at investments strategically, collaboratively, as impactful, and also accountable. You know, having this incredible opportunity to serve as the federal co-chair of the Appalachian Regional Commission, I've traveled a little bit. I've been a couple of different places in the region on more than one occasion. And, you know, it's just not unusual, or hasn't been unusual, for folks to come up and say, you know, Earl, you know, if ARC, folks often like to talk about economic diversification and the sort of the next generation, how we're going to really move this region. And they come up and they talk about it and they say, you know, and oftentimes they have a plan, they have their own little plan that they want to share with me. And they say, you know, if ARC just had like a pot of money of like, you know, $50 million, if you just had like $50 million, that you could do a competition and you could really focus on diversification and you could really challenge communities to come back, not with just the regular area development stuff, but, you know, something that diversifies their economy, something that folks in their communities are committed to. You know, that could be good. You could really, you could do some good stuff with that. So, guys, We don't have $50 million. We're probably going to have $100 million. This is an incredible opportunity for us to start this, to have an important step in this process. It's not going to be the end. It's going to be something that we need to be committed to for a while. But it's an opportunity that we've not had before. You know, I start every day from the proposition that Appalachia is the next great investment opportunity in America. And I make that argument, and I argue that case because of the folks who live here, because of the opportunities that there are in healthcare and energy and manufacturing and a whole series of sectors of the economy. But the challenge that we have in order to reach that goal and really to move in that direction is how do we develop the ecosystems that support that work, that build the capacity in West Virginia's communities to achieve that goal. That's what the Power Initiative is about. That's the work we're trying to do. And we really appreciate you guys coming. And we think that when at the end of the day, you're gonna be exhausted when you walk out of this room. Thanks so much.
Thanks, Earl. A couple of faces popped out when Earl was talking, and I could just see the wheels turning in a couple of places of saying, you know, I've got a great idea. And yeah, I'd love to have $500,000, but I can't possibly justify $500,000. My project's $150,000. Part of the reason that we have you all here in a room like this is the solution to your problem may be sitting over here. We want you to talk to each other, especially those of you who have projects that are smaller. Find someone who has a similar project and partner with them to create that opportunity, because administratively, this is a bigger grant project competition simply because of the administrative responsibilities associated with it. So if you're sitting over there and you've got a great project to help lift up your community, but it's $150,000, you need to come over here or back there and find a partner to make that a $500,000 grant. That will make your grant more competitive. That's part of what Earl has been telling folks around the region. So that's why you're all here in a great big room, and I would encourage you to kind of play musical tables today and mix yourself around. The next group of people that are speaking are getting to the root of the effort. This is the section called Keys to Successful Grant Writing, and our next speaker is Costas Skordas, who is from the Appalachian Regional Council. He will be followed by Jerry Swartz, also from the ARC, and Tracy Rowan, my friend from the EDA. So, ladies and gentlemen, Costas.
Good morning. Good morning. How are we doing today? All right. Thank you all for being here. My name is Scott Hamilton. I'm the executive director of the Appalachian Regional Commission in Washington, and it's an honor to be here. I am just pleased to see everybody here to take the time to come out and to learn about this. I know the folks in West Virginia, y'all have been talking about power and knowing about this opportunity and working together, and the secretary just made some great comments about the collaborations and networking and talking, and that it is extremely important. At lunch today, it's an open thing. We don't have a presentation during lunch because we want you to be talking about some of the opportunities that are going to be going on. We have a list of federal partners that are going to be with us today in panels, and you can see in your agenda the folks that are going to be here. We're going to ask them to sit at different tables throughout the room. So you can sit down and chat with them during lunch. They can talk with you, you can meet with them, you can start to develop those relationships. So we're gonna have folks, we don't want all of the ARC folks at one table and all the federal partners at one table and some of the, the local development districts here, just your staff all at one table. We want y'all to spread out and get to know some folks and really start to do some networking, because this is, as the federal co-chair and the secretary said, a great opportunity to look at the way these dollars can be invested in a little different way, in a different manner, than we invest the area development dollars that ARC has been traditionally known for. So this is a great opportunity for that. So today and this morning, we're going to talk a little bit more into detail. Earl talked about the arc.gov/power website. You're going to hear a lot about that. We're going to really try to drill in. So if there are a couple of things you remember from today, that's going to be one of those. At that website, was mentioned that we've done some webinars, and we actually do have a webinar going to happen today and later this afternoon on Match. We have done some as a general overview of power. Costas did one on research as well. We did one on the FFO, the Future Funding Opportunity, about power. Did one on technical assistance, on the opportunities that are available for you, and we're going to be talking about these on the agenda today. Today's is on Match, and that's this afternoon online. You're thinking, well, how am I going to be able to be here and listen? Well, we've recorded all of those webinars that we've done. And does anybody know where they may be posted? arc.gov/power. That's right. So history, you can go there tomorrow and look at it. As mentioned, this is being live streamed today. We will be in Alabama next week doing this same thing with some folks there for Alabama and Mississippi about the regional power workshop. And that's going to be live streamed as well. So if you want to listen in on that, if you felt like you missed something today, you'll have that opportunity. If you know some folks that weren't able to get here today, encourage them to go to the arc.gov/power website and check out the URL, and they would be able to watch the live stream next week from Alabama if they weren't able to do so today. So this next session, the Power Initiative and Implementation Grants. As mentioned, Costas Gordas with ARC is going to come up. Costas heads our research department, and he's going to talk to you about how do you know if you're coal impacted, and how do you show to us that you are. Jeff Schwartz with ARC, he is our power manager at ARC, and he's going to talk about the ARC FFO and what we're looking at, and go into a little more detail than what our federal co-chair did in his comments just a few minutes ago. And Tracy Ryan from his EDA is going to talk to us about the EDA perspective on power. And so we appreciate you being here this morning as well. So we are running just a tad behind, but that's okay. We're going to make up for it. But I'm going to call on Costas now to talk to you about the data and research associated with being a coal-impacted community. Costas.
Good morning, everybody. Hopefully you can hear me. And thank you, Scott. As Scott mentioned, my name is Costas Gordas. I direct the Research and Planning Division at ARC, and I'm just going to talk briefly about really a key question that you all should ask yourselves as you're preparing power applications, as you're thinking about crafting applications and getting partners, which is, how do I begin to tell my story in my community, however you define that? That can be a group of counties, it can be the entire state, it can be multi-state even. But how do you determine what is a coal-impacted community? Where are resources out there that you could use to document that impact? And finally, you know, the next step, which is how you begin to craft your applications, which is the point of our session here. So we know, in terms of coal impact, that since 2011, over 23,000 jobs have been lost in the coal mines in Appalachia. And that's really a staggering loss if you think about it. You know, these are individuals or families that are impacted. It's a little hard for me sometimes to look at some numbers like these and pretend it doesn't have real impact, but it does. That's about 37% of the job that are really the direct jobs at coal companies. That's not the indirect effects. That's not the businesses that depend on the coal supply chain. And Appalachia, we know, has been hit disproportionately hard. In fact, about 87% of all of the coal mine job losses nationwide are in the region. And of course, the region has 13 states, but Central Appalachia has been hit even harder. Places like right here in West Virginia, Eastern Kentucky, Southwest Virginia, Ohio, these states, you know, what's traditionally thought of as coal country, has been hit hardest. That's not to diminish losses, of course, further north in places like Pennsylvania, Maryland, Ohio, and then of course further south in Alabama, where we'll be next week for another workshop like this. Another key component to determining coal impact is your community's relation to the coal-fired power plants that we know exist in the region, are certainly adjacent to the region. You have maps in your packets, and if you cannot see the maps on the screen, I apologize, I know it's a little distant, but the yellow dots represent where these power plants exist in the region. And we know, of course, there's been reduced demand for coal, so that's really having an impact on the power plants in the region, and of course, jobs related there. In fact, about 36% of coal from the region is destined for in-state markets. We know a lot of it is exported, a lot of it goes to other parts of our country, but much of it is actually found, is transported here closer to home for in-state markets. So places, really, power plants along the Ohio River, which is close by, northern West Virginia, parts of southwest PA, but even further south as well. And according to a report by the Government Accounting Office, much of the planned power plant retirements have impacted Appalachia pretty hard. In fact, impacted four states, West Virginia, Pennsylvania, Ohio, Kentucky. This is really traditionally thought of as coal country, as I mentioned. And these have an impact now, and they will continue to have an impact, as a lot of these power plants are decommissioned, they're closed, they are transitioning to other sources of energy, and we know those have impacts for jobs at those facilities. Another key consideration that you should think about as you're crafting your application is, what is the relationship between the coal mines and the coal-fired power plants to all of the indirect suppliers, the supply chain businesses, the transport networks in the region. And I mentioned coal and rail in particular, because we know that coal plays an oversized role in rail movements in Appalachia. There's a lot of coal that is transported by rail, some of it, of course, by other modes like barges and trucks, but coal is has a strong tie with rail movements in the region, and that, we know, has an impact. So we have some resources at ARC. There's plenty at the state level as well, and other federal entities. But I want to just mention one that's accessible at arc.gov/power, as has been mentioned before. It's a research report that we published recently, just a few weeks ago, that looked at trends in the coal industry, provides an overview of what's happening with all the different components of coal, and probably most importantly for you, include some data sets that you're going to find very useful, that has production, employment at the coal mines for every county for the past 15 years. And so it's quite a large data set, and if you have questions about it or need help interpreting it or documenting it, please let us know. I'm here all day, and you can also email us as well if you have questions about that. But they are for your benefit, for your use as you're completing your power applications. And we're looking to do some additional research as well, as I mentioned, the supply chain impacts, and that's a little bit tougher to do, but certainly no less important, and we are embarking on working with the commission to further examine what happens downstream with the effects of the coal industry decline. And we know those impacts continue for years in advance. So we're working with a little bit more research to better examine, better understand that. A couple reports I'll mention. There's a diversity report online as well that's accessible, that looks at some economic diversification trends and some case studies Power, of course, is about helping diversify the economy, and there's been many places in the region who have tried to diversify and have had much success doing so. And you can access all of the case studies and the online web tool there to analyze your community, your county. And of course, there's other topical studies as well that you might find interesting, particularly on broadband, telecommunications in the region, other emerging trends like local food systems and agriculture, and as well as labor force and workforce issues as well that you'll probably find pretty useful as you're thinking about how to craft your power application. And finally, we are by no means the only source of data. There are excellent resources at the state level. The West Virginia Colfax, for example, Kentucky Colfax, other states have similar reports that you should reference. State data centers and workforce and labor departments can also help you determine what has been the impact in your community, however you define it. And as well, there are many federal resources from the Energy Information Administration, from the Bureau of Economic Analysis, the Bureau of Labor Statistics. There's just a lot of data out there. And that's, you know, understanding how your community has been impacted is really the first step in a power application. As I mentioned, I'm here all day, and we're also accessible if you have questions later via email as you are crafting your application and you think of stuff that you may want some help with. Please let us know. All of that is accessible at arc.gov/power. So thank you.
Good morning. There are some folks that I recognize in the audience who are not from West Virginia. So I just want to do a quick check, and I want to see who's here. I know I saw a few folks that I know from Ohio. Could you just stand up real quick, identify yourselves? Okay, so we are multi-state in this workshop. Thank you. I know it's a bit of a drive, but is there anybody from Pennsylvania? Maryland? Kentucky? Oh, Maryland. Great. How about Kentucky? That's not too far. We have some Kentuckians. Virginia, it's a little farther. All right, well, we have a Virginian. Great. So we've got four states represented. That's excellent. Please take everybody's words to heart. And as we go through the day, try to meet everybody here. Try to circulate around, make some new friends. I'm going to be going through the implementation FFO. I'm going to talk to you about what we're looking for, what we're doing. And my colleague Tracy Rowan from EDA and I are going to sort of tag team this. We released the FFO jointly, and you can see there that we've got this joint amount of money there. It represents both organizations, but as Earl mentioned, the law did not change either of our regulations or processes. So you can go onto one website. You can submit one single pre-application or proposal. You can include money for either ARC or EDA or request money from both agencies in a single application, or I should say pre-application. But when we look at it, we have to look at it separately, so keep that in mind. So we're going to talk about this side, this box right here, the big one. And as we go through the basics, Earl mentioned these are the size of grants that we're looking for. They are not absolute limits. If you're looking at a project at $400,000, $450,000, oh, you just missed it, no. If you're a little bit over $2 million, $1.5 to $2 million, come talk to us. These are not absolute limits, these are guidelines. We are using a two-phase process. That's good and that's bad. You can submit the pre-application and we'll review it. And it's, in my mind, it's more of a conceptual review. There are a lot of really good projects out there. And when we review them, we say, is this going to be a good fit for ARC? Within that, is this a good fit for the power initiative? And then within that, how strong a project is it? Does it address our priorities? We're not looking for letters of support and engineering studies and all that right now. We'll get that later if and when.
After we reviewed the pre-application, or if you're an EDA, it's a proposal, we may request a full application, and that's the step two. For ARC projects, everybody I think here is familiar with our footprint. The nice thing about partnering with EDA is if you have a neighboring county that may not be part of the ARC footprint, they can still be included, and EDA does not discriminate by geography. They do have their criteria for distress. It's different from ARCs, and when Tracy comes up here in a little bit, she'll talk about the EDA criteria for distress. These are the power objectives for the entire administration. I think Earl mentioned these a lot, and we've got some funding priorities that everybody in the administration is taking a look at. ARC has looked at those, and we have drawn a narrower focus. Not much narrower, but it is a little bit of a focus, and we're calling them priorities. They are not absolute priorities, but they are priorities. They're things that we think are going to make a difference, that we know from our background, you have to touch some of these bases to make a difference, but we also realize that our region is so broad and so diverse that one set of absolute priorities cannot be applied everywhere. We have to have the flexibility to adjust for local circumstances, but you need to make the case for that. The first group are four types of projects that we're looking at. Earl mentioned these: building a competitive workforce. You can't change the economy if your workforce can't do the job. Enhancing access and application of broadband. When we get some broadband communications in there, I know Netflix subscriptions go up. They did at my house, that's great. But that's not the highest and best use, and that won't affect the economy of the local region. We need to foster entrepreneurial activities. We do have industrial cluster development down there, but we know we can't bring in enough businesses to employ everybody who wants to live and work here. We have to grow our own, and that takes a whole suite of activities. Within that, if you've worked with ARC, you know that we're very specific on the outcomes that we want, and we ask you to project specific numbers. And if there's one screen from this whole slideshow that you remember, make it this one. Because we're looking at the outcomes as our return on investment. Are you going to be creating enough jobs or filling enough jobs with a workforce that you train? Or creating enough businesses to justify the investment that you're requesting? And again, these are not absolute priorities. So if you do have other outcomes that are different and you're not touching on one of these, we will consider that, but you need to make the case for it, and your other areas are going to need to be much stronger. And those other areas are right here. We have seven criteria. These are listed in the FFO. And not that I've been looking at it for a long time, but it's on pages 22 and 23 where you can find the definitions for each of these. Think of these as the evaluation criteria. It's not going to be enough to say, oh yes, we're regional and focused, we're serving five counties. How are five counties participating? We're in three states. Well, how are you going to be in those three states? How is each state participating? How are they going to benefit? Large and scale. We know that there are a lot of really small projects that are very impactful at a local level, but if you really want to change the economy of a region, you've got to go deep, and that usually takes money. That's why these grants are being offered at a much larger level than our usual grant. We've got the opportunity. We want to take advantage of it. Targeted towards economic restructuring. If you're doing the same old stuff that you've been doing for a while, it's good, it's useful, but if it hasn't restructured the economy yet, it probably is not going to. That may be a better fit for our regular program. We're looking at things that are going to be a little different. Maybe different for you, maybe different for the world, something innovative. but it's got to be something that's going to change the status quo. And there's that old quote about the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. Well, we're expecting different results, so we don't want people just doing what they've always done. We're looking for something different. We don't know what that is. It's going to be, as I said, a very diverse region. We're going to have to do things differently everywhere, but keep that in mind. And collaborative. You can't do it alone. We know that you're really good and very effective at what you do, but to really make a difference, you're going to have to get a lot of other people to buy in. And you can't do the work all by yourself. I know it feels like you do, but you're going to have to get other people to buy in and to participate with this. Or after a year, 2 years, 3 years, when the money is gone, what happens to the project? Nothing. So it needs to be collaborative. If you're working in 5 counties across 2 different states, you want to have partners in each of those counties. Evidence of leverage. We're going to talk about match later, but we have this fund here that we can invest, and we can use that to bring in other resources. It may not be a part of the project budget, but without this investment from ARC and EDA coming in, the other resources would not become available. That's leveraging in, whether it be a company that decides to invest private income after the fact. If you do this, if you train these workers, we'll invest a couple of $1 million and open up a new assembly line. It's not a part of your budget, but it's a leveraged private investment, and we want to see that. There may be resources that are not cash that come in. It could be forms of equipment or other resources that are made available to the community as a direct result of your project comes in. And I'm going to repeat it again, outcomes. The projects need to be outcome driven. We do have our priority outcomes, I mentioned them. But whatever the outcome is, if you're not touching on one of our priorities, because of where you are, you've got some unique needs, you still need to show that your project is outcome driven. And how many of you have had a workforce or education grant that I administered through ARC? Just raise your hand. A couple of you. Most of you don't know me. We want you to specify the numbers up front when it comes to workforce. If you say, oh, we're going to train 500 workers, I say, great, how many will get jobs? And then you go back to the businesses that will be hiring those people, and you train the people for the jobs. It's outcome driven, with the businesses telling you the qualifications they need. Now, I'm using that as an example because that's my background. When my colleagues David and Mark talk, they're going to talk about cluster development. Costas will talk a little bit more about entrepreneurship. Mark is going to talk about broadband, and they'll use examples from those backgrounds. Tracy is going to talk about some other examples. But whatever it is, it needs to be outcome driven because that's the goal that we have. It has to reach that goal. Okay, Tracy?
Hi. How many people here have had an EDA grant in the past? Okay, so we have quite a few people that are used to working with our system. I'm only gonna vary just a little bit. I'm really, really pleased to be here. I've been on the ground 5 months with EDA, and the reason we're part of this today is the Philadelphia Regional Office has $7.5 million to put into the 13 states that have coal impact. And of course, not all of those have coal impact. As I continue to tell my boss every time I talk to her, West Virginia has the most coal impact. So we're really looking to put some funding into the state. And most of you all know the EDA process with the power program. There are some differences. And you all know how accessible I am. You can contact me anytime. And anyway, just excited to be here. The EDA power objectives and priorities. The alignment integration of multiple federal resources in support of coal communities that strive to diversify the economies, create new jobs in new or existing industry, attract new sources of job-creating investment, and provide a range of workforce services and skills training, including work-based learning opportunities, resulting in industry-recognized credentials for high-quality and in-demand jobs. define coal communities. We do not have an established eligibility list for impacted coal communities. Communities and regions that can reasonably demonstrate impact or anticipated impact resulting from job loss and layoffs, coal mining and or coal power plant, and or manufacturing or transportation logistics supply chains. You can get creative here. I can't imagine that there's very many counties in West Virginia that you can't show some type of impact. I'm gonna pick on Region 1 Planning and Development Council again. They had a county that didn't have a lot of coal impact, but they went in and looked at the job loss in the manufacturing industry that supported the coal industry. And they were able to show a 57% loss over just a few year period of time. It wasn't a coal plant closing, or coal-powered plant closing, nor was it actual job layoffs, but you know, a 57% job loss in a county based on manufacturing positions that supported the coal industry most certainly qualifies for power. The WARN notices, the West Virginia Workforce website, you can go on, and there's so many tools on that website that will just show you the layoffs, the WARN notices. Like I said, there's very few counties in West Virginia that you can't make an argument for the power program. Okay. Sorry, I didn't bring my readers, and I'm struggling to see. Okay, whoops. Power implementation funds are targeted to coal communities and regions that have already completed and approved comprehensive strategic plans to address economic diversification, workforce development, and building economic resilience in coal-dependent communities. Project applications that cannot demonstrate a clear link between the project and the existing strategic plan will not be considered for funding by EDA. Any of you all that have worked with EDA know we work with the SEDS. The Community and Economic Development Strategies. There are 11 Regional Planning and Development Councils in the state, and if you have a project and you have not reached out to them yet, please do so. A lot of the priorities are very broad-based, but we are going to expect collaboration with your local economic development district and their SEDS. Thank you. That was a lot. I don't know why I didn't think the print was going to be so small. But on that note, actually, I'm done. I'll be back up in a little bit to talk about MATCH.
And I actually printed this one out bigger this time. I want to go back to this slide for a minute. I would like you to find this one in the handout you've got. If my notes are correct, I think it's slide number 25. Keep that in front of you while I talk about the next couple of slides. We're gonna go through there. Think of this slide as your project evaluation or proposal evaluation criteria. These are the key points I'm gonna talk about. We're gonna go through the process a little bit. I'm gonna try to show you, and Tracy and I are gonna try to show you where they fit in. But when we talk about the process, most people start in the middle and they say, oh, $2 million, I could do so much with that. How do I get it? That's your last question almost your last question to ask. You need to start with, what is the economic strategy? EDA requires that you use the SEDS, the formal comprehensive economic development strategies that are developed by each of the planning development commissions. ARC has a bit more flexibility, but we still want to see what the economic strategy is that you're addressing. So take a look at the towns in the area, the counties, the regions, the states, what are the economic strategies that are guiding their development, their comprehensive economic development? That tells you what the needs are that have already been identified by those communities. Once you've looked at the needs, figure out, what are you going to do about it? What's your solution to that need? And to the people sitting over there, I'm sorry, you can't see my pointer on the screen, but it's a little too far for me to aim. So you've got your strategy, the needs identified, you're looking for a solution. The next thing you need to do is define your geography. One of the nicest aspects of the Power Initiative is that we're no longer constrained by the lines drawn on a map years ago.
Get beyond those lines. Workers do not stop at the county border or the state line when they're going to a job. Industries do not set up on one side of a line or the other simply because they set up on both sides to take advantage of whatever they can. So look at the labor shed, look at the industry cluster, the footprint, the market area. Look at what the natural geography is for your project. In some cases, you may need to scale it down to make it a little bit more manageable. We've got barges that go up and down the rivers from the Canadian border down to the Gulf of Mississippi, carrying coal that are no longer doing that. That's a bit of a region to try to manage into a single project. So you need to cut it down to something manageable. But if you're looking at the river, you want to be sure that you're including both Ohio and the West Virginia sides, because that is a single labor shed that goes along there. Once you've found the geography, then you're going to know who you should be looking to as collaborators. Look at all the players in that area. They've all got to be a part of it. Then, as I said before, there are a lot of really good projects out there. Not all of them are going to be good projects for ARC or EDA. If yours is, if it's a fit for ARC and EDA, then figure out, is it a fit for power? Are you addressing enough of our priorities or of EDA's priorities to make it a good fit for power? And that's where you ask the question, if I just had, how did I get it? Well, now we're going to talk about the how. There are several steps involved. Some of them are rather simple, and we don't have time to go through all of them today. If I could stay here for the next 3 days and keep you all captive, we could. But we're going to focus on these three that are in bold. Although I will mention about registering in the web portal to submit a pre-application, you need to have an email address, you have to create your own password, and you have to be able to type that same password over and over again exactly the same way every time you log in. The biggest difficulty we have with the website is getting those 8 characters in a row exactly the same every time. But we're going to focus on the identifying information that you need to gather before you even start online. You're going to have to get some numbers and a few other things together. The ED900. We're doing this as a partner. We're using one of EDA's forms, their standard pre-application, or they call it a proposal form. ARC is using that too. Even if you're not requesting money from ARC, from EDA, you still need to use that form. And we've put that in electronic version up on our web portal. Even if you're not requesting money from ARC, you still go through the same web portal. And then we're going to talk about how you can check statuses without calling or contacting, emailing us every day. Have you reviewed it yet? Have you reviewed it yet? We'll show you about that. This is the information you need. Most people know about the EINs. You need to be incorporated. You need to have a tax identification number or employer identification number that you get from IRS. A lot of you work for organizations. You need to make sure that you have access to that EIN and you know what it is. In addition to the EIN, there's something called a DUNS number. All grantees and contractors for the federal government must have one. Usually you can get it almost immediately. You can call up on the phone or you can get it online. Sometimes it'll be a 1-hour delay. However, when a large organization such as the U.S. Department of Education or the EDA in Washington, D.C. has a grant deadline coming and everybody's requesting those numbers at the same time, it can take 3 to 5 business days or more. Don't do it at the last minute. Get your DUNS number. If you already have one, check and make sure it has not expired. They do expire. EDA also requires a SAMS CAGE code. No, I'm not going to tell you what those acronyms mean. Just make sure you have the right code, the code number to fill in on the block. Also, be sure that for both the DUNS and the CAGE code, there's usually one per organization. If you're at a large university, and I saw some people here with you or something on their badges, each department does not get their own number. There's usually one for the university. Again, the CAGE codes do expire. Make sure yours is current. You don't want to get halfway through a grant, put in a request to get reimbursed for $855,000 and find out that your code has expired and nobody can send you the money until it's renewed. Keep those current. This is the lovely ED900P. Isn't that a great name for a form? You gotta love it. We have taken each of the items on this. Now you can go to our website, and what was that website address? And if you, it's on the bottom left corner of every slide. If you haven't been there yet on your phone or your laptop, you're falling behind. You can go to our website. In the resources section, there's a checklist for the implementation FFO. You can open that up, and it'll take you to a hard copy of this form. Be aware that for ARC, in the FFO on the last section H, pages 23 and 24, if you're counting, there are some special requirements for ARC, a few additional items that we ask you to upload, or a few specific answers that we ask you to, a few details we ask you to include. But this slide that I ask you to keep in mind, what I want to do now is go through some of these questions in the pre-application process and show you where these items need to be addressed, where they fit in. We're only going to go through the first half of the form. The last half is construction, and it's kind of, if you don't have an engineer or an architect working with you, you shouldn't be working on it. You're going to need their budget. If you either have an environmental review done or you don't. Either you're going to own the building or you're going to know who does. They're more straightforward questions, but the first half are required of everybody, construction and non-construction alike, and we're going to go through those. And Tracy, I'll invite you to come up and chime in whenever you want to. You've looked at a few of these, I've looked at a few of these, so we're going to talk very quickly through them, but to give you an idea of where these items fit in. Please.
Getting started on this, if you go into grants.gov to put in a standard EDA application, and a number of you have done that, you know it limits your characters, okay? You get halfway through your narrative and you can't put any more characters in. I just want to point out on the ARC portal, the 900P, you're not limited. The characters, you can put a large narrative in there where with EDA it would cut you off. So as he's going through these different categories, you know, a lot of times you're thinking, how do I make it narrow enough to go on to grants.gov? You don't have to do that on the ARC portal, and it makes you can put in a lot more information than you could under a standard EDA grants.gov application. No.
Yeah, the general guidance is when you print it all out, without the attachments and a couple of standard federal forms, think about 5 pages of text is what we're looking for. But there's no hard and fast limit. There is no character count. I don't think there's something that'll cut you off, at least nobody's run into it yet, and we did have one application that was 120 pages. If I get one more of those, we might put a character limit in there. So you can see here, in section one, question one, description of the applicants, we want to know who the partners are. Remember, the P in power stands for partnership. It's nice if our congressional representatives send you letters of support, but they're not your partners. The partners are the people actually doing the work. The partners are the for-profit businesses that are going to be hiring the staff that you're training. The partners are the communities that are making resources available to you. Some of them may be providing some cash as part of their contribution. Others may be providing space or other resources. Let us know, who are your partners? What are their roles? We want to make sure that this is a collaborative project going forward. Describe the region. And again, here, this for ARC, we'd like you to include the specific counties that are going to benefit and tell us how. We need you to demonstrate a regional focus. One of the things that's not up here, but we also ask you to upload a map of the counties. We just need to see where they are. We want a description of the project. And these are some of the items that we feel from our priorities that need to be highlighted in the description. If your description doesn't show it, when you're done, type this up on a different, on a word processor someplace. You can cut and paste and insert it into the website later. Show it to somebody who knows nothing about your project. Give them these four questions and say, show me the answers to those questions in this description. And if they can't do it, there's something that's not clear enough. Keep in mind that when the ARC review team looks at your pre-application, there may or may not be somebody from West Virginia on the team, but the rest of the team will only know what's on that, I was going to say on that paper, but they're only going to know what you type on into the system. We're not looking for hundreds of pages, but we do need to make sure that you cover these points so that we can see, yeah, it is outcome driven. It shows that it will lead to economic restructuring because it's based on a specific plan. There are leveraged resources in there. Question four asks about the need. Do not upload your SEDS. I'll take your word for it, but tell me which SEDS it's addressed in. Just give the citation. Go back to school and those research reports you wrote, and they taught you how to do a citation. If you don't have that memory, talk to your children or your grandchildren, as the case may be. No, I'm not going to ask for the formal APA style. I don't really care what style it is, but just tell me where you got the strategy, give me the citation, and a brief quote that gives me the gist of what that strategy is. Don't upload your full SEDS or the full strategy. We or EDA may ask for that as part of the full application, but for this, we just want to know that you do have it based on economic development strategies. In many cases, if you're working with multi-counties and across state lines, you may be citing more than one strategy or more than one statement, and the different strategies in each one will be referenced to show how you're fitting in with that whole broad region. What is your basis of distress? EDA is going to be talking about this in a little bit when we talk about match. They use the term distress differently from ARC. For ARC, we have our distressed counties code, and we do everything by county. I'll talk about that more when we talk about matching contributions as well. Outcomes, it keeps coming back. Don't just tell me you're going to create jobs, tell me how many. And please, I used to be a teacher, but I'm not a student anymore. I do not want multiple choice tests. Give me one number, not a range. I don't want to have to pick something in between. We're going to create between 50 and 100 jobs. Okay, how many? Give me a number. And you can base it on the fact that from our experience working with this type of project, our business incubator will likely create 12 new businesses over the next 24 to 36 months. Beautiful. We want some specific numbers. If you're going to be doing something with broadband, how many people are going to be connected to it, or how many miles of fiber will be laid, or whatever that is. But we need those outcomes. Environmental concerns or public controversy. If there's something that's controversial, give us a heads up. It will not rule you out offhand, but if we're aware of it, we can hopefully address it before it becomes something in the press, before it gets out of hand. Maybe you just wrecked the governor's car. Let us know that, and we can smooth it over with his driver first. Make sure that's all okay. But yeah, let us know if there's any controversy or if there are any environmental concerns. And that has more to do with building and infrastructure projects, but it could also have to do with commuter patterns or something else where you think people might be upset and protest about it. It's much easier and much better and makes for a much smoother process if we can get these identified up front and then work forward. There is a ninth question that I didn't put up there. EDA wants you to read their regulations for grant administration first. Please do. ARC doesn't require it prior, but you can go onto our website and get our grants administration manual. And if you can't find it, I have one of the easiest emails in the world, power@arc.gov. It's one of the perks of the job. I had a new email. You can read ours as well, but EDA requires that you read theirs. Check the box, yes, if you're applying for EDA funds. Once you've gone through and uploaded all of your application and all the right people have signed off on all the right forms and you've clicked submit, and a little warning box comes up and says, are you sure? And you say yes, and then it gets, your application is locked. You can no longer edit it. But what was that email? Send me a little, if you say, oh, we forgot this. Or somebody just came in, we have a new partner, you need to revise it. Or we just noticed that there was a mistake. Send me an email, I can unlock it. I can return it to you. You go through the signature process again. You can revise it. The same thing happens from ARC side too. If we decide not to request a full application, I will send you an email. I'll give you the main comments that were made by the review committee, and your application is unlocked. If you wish to revise it, I strongly recommend that you talk to my colleagues, me and my colleagues at ARC, talk to James Bush and his team in the state, talk to your Planning Development District Commission. If you're requesting EDA funds, talk to this woman here. If you're from Ohio, talk to Robin Bush. Where's Robin? You in the office? Stand up, Robin. Robin is working with the Ohio EDA program. So if you're from Ohio, talk to Robin. Tracy will talk to you too, but she's nicer to Ohio people. All right. You can go online. You can sign into the Power Portal. It's designed thinking that you're going to be working on more than one application at a time. You'll get your own little dashboard. You'll see all the applications that have your name and your email associated. You pick the one you want to look at, and it'll tell you the status. Not submitted, submitted, under review, returned for information, full application requested. You can go up there, you can see the status at any time. If you do have questions, if it's up there for 2-3 weeks, you say, oh, it's still not under review, send me an email at Power. I got an email last night that I realized I forgot to change the status on one. That happens sometimes. I'm running around a lot. I hope it doesn't get dropped in the weeds. But check first, and please be patient. The team is here. So we're reviewing these, we're working as fast as we can.
Just one last comment. James and I can't count anymore how many white papers I've reviewed. I don't know about you, James, but one of the things that we're willing to do, and my cards are back here, if you're looking at EDA funds, I'll review a draft of the application prior to the submission process. If you're looking for ARC funds, James has been reviewing those. If you're looking for both ARC and EDA funds, we strongly recommend, because the criteria can be a little bit different when you're trying to get both agencies to work together, that you submit white papers to James and myself just to let us give you some advice, make sure you're checking off all the boxes that Jeff has mentioned here earlier. We have a lot of them to review. Sometimes it takes me a couple days, but not much over a couple days to get to any of them that I've gotten so far. I brought 3 or 4 with me today so that when there's downtime, I can be marking them up and give comments. So just wanted to make sure you knew that was available to any of you all that might need a little assistance.
Hey, 2 things. Don't give her any downtime. While she's here, talk to her. Yeah, we're going to take a few minutes right now and see. There's been a lot of information. Before we go into the next step, what questions you might have on the FFO process or on the research. Anything about, except we won't answer questions on the weather. We've got a couple of microphones. I'm going to grab one of these up here, and one of my colleagues will grab one of these.
And looked at it,
Let's take a second and think about a couple of opportunities. You've got some great people here to be able to ask your questions to. We are a little behind if you're looking at the agenda, but we build in a little bit of opportunity to catch up. So I'm going to come right over here. We've got a question.
Yeah, I'm Jennifer Simon. I'm with Ohio University. I run the incubator there, and we're working on innovation hubs in partnership with in Kentucky and West Virginia and Ohio. Those partnerships in Kentucky and West Virginia are just kind of gelling. Even some of our partnerships internal to the state are gelling. But some people are ready to go as part of our proposal, our larger proposal. My question is, can we start with the initial proposal, the partners that are ready to go, are ready in that implementation mode, and then, or in addition to, apply for the TA funds to help get the other piece of the entire infrastructure put together?
Yes.
Okay.
As I said, we're set up so that you can apply for multiple grants at the same time. The purpose of the TA is to get ready for an implementation grant. So you've got one part of the implementation grants ready, the other part needs to get ready. Yes.
Okay. Thank you. I'm Ann Jones, Tucker County. And when we think about communities, I'm wondering, can we build, does it make sense to be able to build communities that are not necessarily geographically related? For instance, we see a lot of power projects are going to be using community colleges, I hope. And if we set up, let's say, a sister community between a Southern West Virginia community college and a Northern West Virginia college, can they go together as one group?
You're going to have to answer that question. If you can make the case for it, I'd say yes.
We will.
If you can show how that makes sense for that project, yes.
Hi, I'm Ron Reese from Corporation for Ohio Appalachian Development. We cover 30 counties in Southeast Ohio. My question is about the upper limit on the grant. We do some work with our partners across the river in West Virginia. We would not be able to implement something that covers our 30 counties and part of West Virginia at the 1.5 mil ceiling. So you said talk to us about it. What is a realistic upper limit?
I would refer that question to our federal co-chairman, but I don't think, I think it's what you need. If you can justify the investment with a return on that investment, we'll consider it. What I'd suggest you do is, as Tracy mentioned, put together a summary, send it to me. I will get my colleagues who are in that area to look at it and get some feedback to you.
So I'm assuming that it would be encouraged to work across the river, as you mentioned. We're already doing a lot of work with our colleagues in West Virginia. We'd like to continue that. So you would encourage us to, he's not shaking his head either way, so yes? You would encourage us to go big? Okay.
Yeah. Any other questions? Dave.
Hi, I'm Phil Shank. I'm with the West Virginia Partnership for Elder Living. My question is on the amount of money that's left. We know that there's $1.2 million in the TA grant program. But it's also open application. It would seem to me that you've probably spent some of that, and perhaps also in the implementation. And I'm just wondering if there's a place that we can find how much is left.
Not yet. I'd have to, that's not something that has been asked yet, not something we have thought of.
One of the opportunities that we have with the technical assistance is it's really what we've put out there at this time. If there is a need for more, we have the flexibility within the dollars to be able to provide more funding there for technical assistance. So it's hard to say what is left. It also depends upon the types of projects that are going to be coming in. And some projects may come in as technical assistance applications, but once we review them, they may actually be implementation because of how folks define the word technical assistance. But I would encourage you, if you continue to need the technical assistance, is to reach out to us and continue to communicate with us
in the powerat.arc.gov website, talking with your state, if you're from West Virginia, with James, about the need for technical assistance. And we're certainly going to continue to work with you. Yeah.
I'm sure the information, it's all of our grants are public knowledge and public information that are made available. So we're going to have to look at a system for how we can make the power grants, how we can get those posted online so you can see what's been awarded. I don't think we've awarded any yet. I've been out of the office for a few days, but I don't think any have gone through the final approvals as of yet. But that's something we can work on. Any other questions?
Hi, Mary Hunt with the Benedum Foundation. Might be asking this to Mark, but what are you looking at in broadband applications? Deployment, construction of broadband, as well as what's the application, the level of application that you're looking for, the potential for business development or broadband directly to impact business? What's the range that you might be looking at in those projects?
Jeff, you want to take it? Please, no, Mark.
I think all of them. I think you go back to the checklist of, in terms of how many of the principles you're going to meet and the outcomes, you know, jobs created, jobs obtained, businesses created. It all requires broadband, so I think planning is in the mix. Certainly middle mile facilities is in the mix, and then as Earl stressed, last mile facilities definitely in the mix.
And that gentleman, by the way, is Mark DeFalco. He is the ARC Broadband Program Manager. And the way we're working the Power Initiative at the Commission is that we each have our areas of specialization. I'm not reviewing the grants on broadband. I don't have the background to do that. I'm not reviewing the applications that come in for business development. I'm not providing too much advice on those. That's not my background. I'm in education and training. Dave does a lot with business development. Mark does broadband development. So we can, they're not here, but we also have folks that focus on financing, health, and other areas that we would refer you to. So if you send me a question at power@arc.gov, I'd refer you out to one of my colleagues who can better help you out.
We're going to move on to the next session. I would point out, though, regarding the question about broadband, is we have breakout sessions this afternoon, and that's a great way to remind everybody about our breakout sessions. If you turn to the back of your agenda on the back side of it, from 1:20 to 2:20 are the breakout sessions that we'll be talking about the opportunities of the priorities in power, such as the building a competitive workforce, enhancing access to and use of broadband services, fostering entrepreneurial activities, developing industry clusters in communities. So those will be breakout sessions. Right before lunch, we will tell you where those breakout sessions are. And right after lunch, we will tell you where those breakout sessions are so you can get to those. I would encourage you, if there are several of you from one organization, is to break up and to go to multi-topiced breakout sessions, so each of you can get the information and then come back together and compare notes and be very efficient in, with what you're going to be able to hear, and you make the best use of your time. The next item on the agenda is Joe Cullen. He's a senior policy advisor to the federal co-chair with us at ARC, and Joe is going to talk about the technical assistance grants. Joe.
Great. Good morning, everybody. My name is Joe Cullen, and I work with the Commission on the Power Initiative. And the good news is I normally have 10 minutes. I'll try to be shorter than that, and you are coming up on a break. So you heard from Earl and Keith earlier about the overall big picture items, and Jeff and Tracy just gave you the gory details on some of the implementation applications. I'm going to speak very briefly about technical assistance. And to get started, we have, in general, this morning provided you with a lot of information. It's probably too much to absorb immediately. But I just want to, and in addition to that, we have provided a good deal of information in your packets. So on technical assistance, there are three documents in your packets I just want to let you know are there if you haven't thumbed through them. The first is the 7-page technical assistance FFO. And so one difference between the presentation you just heard and this presentation is this is an ARC-only program. Technical assistance is just provided. The $1.2 million is ARC funding. So we tried to summarize in one short document, the 8-page document, what power is about in general, and then what technical assistance is designed to do. So that is a great, if you haven't taken a look, that's a great document to take a look at. We also have a frequently asked questions document in your packet, which I think will be helpful to kind of flesh out some of the things that we've already heard from people about what might be clear and what might not be clear. And then another very useful document in your packet is there is a list of the questions you will be asked when you get online at arc.gov, which you've heard a few times already. The actual questions for the technical assistance application are laid out there because you know, you have to log in and provide the information. It's good to have that information before you're sitting there in the computer filling it out. So those are three things that I think would be really helpful to just take a quick look at. And I'll make a short plug for the strategic plan that's in your document. If there's three documents that I think everyone really needs to read, I'll give you this homework assignment. It's the two FFOs, the EDA combined with the ARC FFO. To give you the full background on implementation, the technical assistance FFO, which explains the overall program, but the specifics on technical assistance, and then the strategic plan. Many of you, from the hands that were raised earlier, have already worked with ARC in the past. For those of you who have worked with them, you're probably very familiar, but the strategic plan does contain a lot of the aspects that are laid out in the goals and criteria that Jeff spoke about. All right, I'm gonna speed up here on slides. So the big takeaway on technical assistance, what's it for? It's to prepare communities and regions to submit an implementation application. So there's $1.2 million. There are lots of really interesting studies that could be performed, lots of information that could be gathered, lots of things that could be analyzed, but it doesn't matter if it doesn't lead you to an implementation application. So we are really focused on the implementation side. That's where the vast majority of money under POWER is going. So technical assistance grants are for communities and regions to sit down and get their application ready. So that's the outcome that Jeff was emphasizing earlier. The outcome we're looking at is an implementation application. Our online applications for technical assistance will be reviewed on a rolling basis. To the gentleman who asked the question before about is there any money left, there sure is. We have not received a full application for technical assistance yet, so all the money as of this morning is left on technical assistance. And as Scott alluded to, if there's a huge demand, we may be able to do something to accommodate that demand. And we don't set forth in technical assistance FFO, there are no preset limits. You know, if you're applying for this, it's X, or you know, if you're applying for something else, it's another dollar amount. We want you to explain what the outcomes are and connect the dots between what you're applying for and the actual costs. And as I'll say in a minute, a budget document is part of that. So that's a big takeaway. The purpose of technical assistance is to get communities and regions in a position where they can apply. The only part of, so I'm repeating there, but that's the purpose of the technical assistance. So what do we fund? The one challenge in writing the technical assistance FFO was we didn't want to prescribe what we would fund. We are looking for communities and regions to come in and tell us what they need to complete in order to be ready to submit an implementation application. But on page 4 of technical assistance, we do list some examples. So this list is not exclusive. It's what we've seen in the past on projects that help folks get to being in a go position. So on page 4, you will find building a coalition of political, civic, and business and religious and other community leaders. We may help you pay for assembling, interpreting, and analyzing economic and other relevant data. We may help you pay for evaluating current economic development and workforce development assets. We may help fund either strategic plan or perhaps an update of strategic plan. With the emphasis on region and collaboration, it may be that a county has their own strategic plan, but they want to update it to include regional aspects, and we'll certainly fund that based on the application. We might fund a feasibility study as well. And the last thing on our list, but we will fund other things. We're looking for you to explain what your needs are. If they aren't on that list, if it's something else, it doesn't mean that we won't fund it. We just need to see it in your application. So that's the kind of things that we'll fund. And the last thing that we'll fund is we do recognize that when power came out, there's a vast variety and diversity of counties and regions and their ability and preparedness to submit an application. So one of the categories that we will fund is we'll fund grant application writing funding. And in fact, what we did is we set up sort of a fast track on that. So on our application on the website, if you are just applying for grant assistance, it's a fast track application. There's really only seven or eight questions, a budget, and a few other things. So that's one category that your application is relatively straightforward. In the other track two is everything else that I just mentioned in terms of feasibility studies or strategic plans or other things like that. One question we've gotten is, well, if we're going to hire a grant writer and do a strategic plan, can I go on the fast track? And the answer is no. The fast track is just for technical assistance grant writing. And there's a couple questions there, like how did you, what's your competitive process to select your grant writer, and what's your budget, and a few other things. But on the other aspects, we need more information about what it is that you're going to apply. So this is more detail on track one. I'm going to kind of go through that very quickly because of the shortness of time. I am going to be here all day, so if anybody has a technical assistance question, you should please feel free to come up and ask. Happy to answer. But track one, all of the applications will require an SF-424. We need to see the budget information. In a few moments, we'll have a panel up here. They will go into great detail, but those of you who have worked with ARC before, you know there's match requirements. On the technical assistance side, it's just really important to keep in mind that in-kind contributions count as match. Okay, so if it's a lower amount and you have a professor from a community college or someone who's going to be working with you, you can estimate the amount of that contribution and use that as a match for your grant writing application, for example. And as I mentioned before, we'll just need to know a little bit about how you selected your grant writer or your consultant, and that's the track one. On track two, just a couple of notes to make. The questions will be a little bit more detailed than track one to allow you to explain what the technical assistance, what the feasibility study is going to address, or the updated strategic plan, or whatever you're proposing. So there are a few more questions on that, but here's a big difference from that track one. As with other ARC grants, you'll be working, when you submit the technical assistance grant, you'll be working with a case manager on that grant. So you'll have interaction with an ARC staff member once a grant is received and accepted and approved. So that'll be helpful in kind of framing the document. But one last thing that I didn't mention under track one, the reimbursement on grant writing is received after you submit the implementation grant. And it could well be that if you're funded to do a feasibility study and it turns out that the feasibility study says this is not really a viable project, we won't require you to submit an application in that course. So that requirement that the application go in is just for the grant writing side. And you'll work with your case manager on a track two grant, if that makes sense, so that you will hopefully submit an application, but that's not a requirement on the track two. Okay, and with that, I think we are all of the, just the closing thought is all of the criteria that Jeff talked about earlier about objectives, regional, leverage, collaborative, all of those things really apply on the technical assistance side. So we're trying to get communities and regions ready to apply, and that's the overall kind of picture that that we're operating from. And as I mentioned earlier on, the strategic plan is a great reference point for where the ARC is coming from. And with that, I'm...
All right. Joe, thank you. Yes. Joe mentioned that he's going to be here all day. So if you have a question, feel free to reach out and talk with Joe about it on the match. On the technical assistance. We'll be doing the match panels here in just a minute. We will take the break. We're coming right up at 11:30. Just a couple of things that I'd like to mention is, again, if you have a question, you can't catch up with Joe, the power@arc.gov email address would be great resource to send your question to that. On the arc.gov/power website, there is a frequently asked questions section there, so I encourage you to go to that and take a look at that. And the webinar we'll be doing in about 2 weeks from today is really centered on a lot of the frequently asked questions, so don't think that, well, maybe others aren't interested or what. I would encourage you to email questions to the power@arc.gov email address, so we might be able to use one of your questions on our webinar in 2 weeks, which is going to be, like I said, on the frequently asked questions. Right now, I show it's 11:30. We're going to start at 11:45. We're going to take a break. I would ask the panelists that are going to be talking at the on the matching requirements, all the panelists, the federal folks, our partners, if you could be here in 10 minutes, we would like to start promptly in 15. So the panelists, I'm going to need you up front in about 10 minutes. Thank you.